for me? A quorum being present, this town meeting is called to order. Please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. I have a couple of quick announcements. Tonight we will resume with the Charter Article 4 under the Warrant Article 7, together with its proposed amendments. I want town meeting members to feel comfortable discussing and questioning charter proposals before us, but I do need to point out that we are now up against a deadline. In order for any approved charter changes to go before the public on the April ballot, the business of this town meeting must be completed tonight, the whole town meeting. Otherwise, the proposals would need to wait until the next election, presumably in April 2016, and I believe we would have to re-vote everything, too. Also, I'm informing town meeting we now have two instructional motions to be acted upon before this meeting ends. Let me quickly go through them. One is to, and I'm generalizing here, is to look into how and why General Bylaw 8.9.1 was amended in 2011 and report back to town meeting. There are a few other pieces to that. A second one is to see if the town will vote to instruct the Board of Selectmen or Bylaw Committee to review the charter for gender-specific language and replace such terms with modern terminology that is inclusive. We'll get to those later on. I also would like to point out, I think we're just barely over the quorum, so if you could hang in there, that would be greatly appreciated. With that, I believe we are ready to start, and I've got to figure out where we were. 414, I think, the last one.
Associate membership.
Okay, associate membership. We had a proposed amendment made by Mr. Snell, but it was not seconded before the meeting was adjourned. Is that correct? Hello? Back again. Okay. I don't think we have it recorded, do we? We don't have the amendment recorded. Is Mr. Snell here? Okay. Then I guess we don't have it because it was not seconded. If anybody remembers it and wants to make it, I will accept that. All right. With that, we are back into charter. Ms. Binda?
Angela Binda, Precinct 5. I think Mr. Snell's proposal was to eliminate all less than 90 days, the waiting period before a person could vote.
Okay.
That was his.
Okay, so your amendment was to make it 90.
My amendment was to make it 90 because I didn't know whether or not how people felt about eliminating it. If Mr. Snell spoke in favor of eliminating it completely, and I'm actually in favor of that. I don't think that there should be any waiting period. I think that if someone is appointed by the Board of Selectmen to be a member, whether an associate or a full member, that they have been vetted by the Board of Selectmen, they assume the duties. If someone, oftentimes associate members become associate members because membership is full, it doesn't mean that they're less qualified. So if there's an open position, oftentimes people are elected, are appointed to a full position. If there's not a full position, they're often appointed to an associate position. However, one does not mean that one is less experienced than the other. It just sometimes means that full membership is full. So, or complete voting right membership is full. So I think that if the Board of Selectmen appoints someone to the board, whether a full or an associate member, that they should be able to have voting membership. And I understand that an associate member would only have voting privileges in the absence of a full member. So should the full membership, because the board isn't full or because someone is not able to attend a meeting, an associate would step into it. So I would like to, if I'm remembering correctly, I would like to second Mr. Snell's motion to.
He made his motion, it was not seconded. It actually died when the meeting died.
It died, okay.
So you're making...
So then I'm making a new motion.
No, I'm sorry, what I meant to say, it was never seconded. If you want to make the second, then that, I will consider that a motion.
Well, then I will second what I believe to be Mr. Snell's motion, which was to have, to eliminate it completely, any waiting period.
Okay. Excuse me? Can you speak at the microphone?
Okay, so if there's no quorum, it didn't count.
Greg Savatelli, Precinct 6. I think he, if I remember correctly, he mentioned if there was no quorum, then he would want the associate member to be able to vote immediately regardless of timeframe.
That's correct.
Did we have that wording in there?
Well.
We would need that exact wording before we could take a vote.
Okay, so can I amend my motion then? I'm not sure.
Mr. Snell's motion. Actually, if you want to make the motion, you already have a motion. You have the motion
I
for
do.
90 days.
So I'm...
Yeah.
You already made a motion.
Yeah.
I did. So can I second his motion?
Yes. I'm just trying to figure out exactly what his motion is. It sounds like we've got a piece missing from this. The problem is... It died just as he was making the motion. The meeting died. What this gentleman is saying is there was another piece adding about the quorum.
I've already made a motion. I said I can't make another one.
Mr. Doxa? Oh. Point of order. We'll take the point of order first.
Sorry, Jeff Struble, Precinct 7. Is Ms. Bisden... Is her original motion gone?
No.
So she's now got two amendments?
No, she has seconded Mr. Snell's proposed amendment.
I thought she was getting rid of hers.
I didn't hear that.
Is that what you're doing?
Which one's going to be voted on first? Okay.
I will vote on the zero before the 90. That way we would
You'll
not...
vote on the zero before the 90?
Yes.
Then I'll keep on.
Okay. But we need, the problem here is we need to get the wording right. Yes, Mr. Doxa?
Mark Doxa, Precinct 1. I think I can come pretty close to the wording.
Okay.
Which would be after Massachusetts general law, so right before the blue, inserting the words, or in cases where a quorum is not otherwise present.
Okay, hold on one second. I'm going to make sure we get the wording right. In cases, what was the rest?
In cases where a quorum is not otherwise present. It is the next sentence. Sorry, it's not the blue, it was the yellow, my mistake.
After, at the end of the...
Right before the yellow now.
Oh, I see, okay. So it's before the yellow.
It's allowed by Mass General Laws.
Okay. All right, if there's no objection, we will take that as Mr. Snell's motion.
Majority and not just a majority.
Okay, so
that would be a good... Even if you had a quorum, you still wouldn't be able to have a proper vote.
I think that would be an argument to vote.
That would be an argument to vote against it, right? You can make that motion and you can make the argument against it. Mr. Tuttle?
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Dave Tuttle, Precinct 3. It's my understanding of many years on committees, if there is no quorum, then the committee may not convene. Therefore, that phrase is completely moot.
Further discussion? Mr. Crook?
Stephen Crook, Precinct 2. So right now we just have an amendment to change 180 days to 90 days. There was discussion about the merits of deleting that requirement entirely. Would it make life simpler if I made a motion to delete?
Right now we have four proposed amendments.
Okay, is there a motion already to delete the 90-day requirement entirely?
That is the one we just worked on that Mr. Snell made.
Okay, so it's there. All right,
yes.
Never mind then.
Okay. Yes, Mr. Graham.
With all respect, Mr. Moderator, if the motion died, the motion died. So Mr. Snell's motion ought to disappear. Whatever it is we have up there, let's make it a new motion and not have we think he meant, we think he said
well,
this.
You know, as a practical matter, you're absolutely correct. We could do this with a simple second, but it's we're now guessing what he was trying to say. So if somebody wants to make this motion, I'll accept it as a brand new motion. I'm going to wipe this off. Mr. Doxer makes that motion.
I'd like to make that motion. There were two words left off, I'm sorry, from where I was. So, or in cases where there is not a quorum otherwise present.
Okay, is there a second to Mr. Doxer's motion? Second, okay. Thank you. Now, Mr. Arena, I'll get back to you.
Good evening, town meeting members. At the risk of making this longer, selectmen have been mentioned several times tonight. I've sat on the volunteer appointment subcommittee, and the most common case for an associate member, there are two, is an individual who asks to be an associate because they're not comfortable with the setting at the moment. The second is an oversubscription. People want to participate and there's no open seat. The case I'm slightly worried about is the circumstance where we're trying to wordsmith this so that in the circumstance where there's not enough of a quorum, we can have a substitute. If you don't have enough quorum, I believe that's a different problem to be addressed. While I like the spirit of what's being described, it strikes me that you either have a committee or you don't. And I'm fearful that given the temporary nature of most associate memberships, you don't necessarily have the subject matter to vote with the full understanding of the issues. The second point I would make is the most powerful argument in the room is the one that usually wins, and it doesn't matter who it comes from. It often can be somebody who walks in the room. We've heard that this tonight where new people have walked into town meeting and made perfectly reasonable arguments, even though they may not have had the experience. So it strikes me that associate members by themselves, whether they may not have a formal vote, probably have as much authority in reasoning as any other member of the board. I'm in favor of the original language, namely the 180 days, to avoid the circumstance where somebody coming on board for a single issue is able to persuade the outcome. Either that failing, I'd be in favor of leaving it as is today, where associate members are associate members and persuade through the merit of their wisdom and reasoning rather than a formal vote. I'm not being disrespectful of associate members, rather. Again, if you don't have quorum, you don't have quorum. That's a different problem to be solved, not by finding the next guy that walks in the room and putting him in the seat. Thank you.
Further discussion? Mr. Brown? Oh. Mr. Pacino?
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Phil Pacino, Precinct 5. The intent of the bylaw was that the right of voting members would be set by bylaw. That it would not be set as part of the charter. So the intent was that it would be part of the bylaws and not part of the charter. I mean, in terms of, that's why we left the first part in, that it be set by either bylaw, through charter, or through mass laws. And, you know, if that amendment passes, then I'm not sure where we're going to go with this, but with all these amendments. So the intent was that the appointing authority would determine what the voting rights are. If you want it to be that it's to be set by, you know, in this case of a quorum, leave that to the appointing authority to determine that. That's who we visualized setting these rules, not the charter. We have visualized that the appointing authority would be the one that set the rules. We potentially, maybe if you wanted to, and I haven't even talked to my co-author about this, whether he would agree, potentially, we could remove that last sentence where it starts in no case and just remove that whole section, if that's what the intent was, and leave it up to be part of the bylaws in terms of that.
Further discussion? Yes.
I'll second the motion.
Okay. Are you actually making a motion?
I'll
also move that, Mr. Moderator.
So what is your exact motion?
Get rid of everything after Mass General Laws.
After where?
Everything that's up there in blue right now. Way down. Come way down to the second paragraph.
There, stuff in the box.
The stuff in the box. Okay, the stuff in the box. I think that'll pass by everybody.
Intent at the first section.
and with the intent that the first section should be left in. Yeah. Is that what you're saying, Phil?
We now have five amendments on the floor, so.
That takes care of, I think, everybody's concern.
Except the glasses, yellow.
Yeah.
What we will do then when we get to it is we will take, it seems like that would take care of the two previous.
Yeah.
So we will try that one first, probably. Is that correct? If the bottom three, yeah. So when we get to it, we would start with yours, yeah. And then we'd move backwards. Further discussion in four. That people haven't spoken yet? Mr. Donnelly Moran.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Charles Donnelly Moran, Precinct 7. I do have a comment on and an amendment on Section 4.9 Housing Authorities. Do you want to wait until we finish dealing with associate members, or should I?
At this point, it's getting so confusing. I would like to. Let's limit debate to the amendments that are on the floor. We'll take
okay.
care of them.
Good.
I think it'll be smoother. It's getting very confusing. So from here, we're going to talk about the at least those last three amendments. You want to talk about that? Yes, Mr. Barnes.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Jonathan Barnes, Precinct 5. I have several comments and would like to be given the opportunity to address this and other sections. I had intended to address Section 4.8 first because I would like to briefly revisit your decision on that. But since we're at this point, I would like to address this. And if I understand it correctly then, there is currently, among several motions, a motion to strike the sentence that says, in no case may an associate member vote on any issue if he has served as an associate for less than 90 days. Is that correct?
Everything that's in the box is what I made a motion to strike.
Okay, so I would then strongly support that and urge town meeting to strongly support that as well. For several reasons, which I hope I can succinctly raise. First of all, with respect to this entire issue of associate membership, I understand many members' expression and town council and others' expression that much of this matter can and should be addressed in town bylaws, and perhaps that is appropriate. But it is not inappropriate to address it here for several reasons, not the least of which is that the provision provides for providing rules and regulations and procedures, as I'm looking at it right here, except as allowed by the charter. So we may have the option of presenting it as a bylaw, but we certainly also have the option of presenting it in the charter. And I see no reason why we ought not do that now. I point out that there is a reference in the section dealing with the ZBA specifically to associate members, and I think that's appropriate, but all my point is it is appropriate here as well as in a bylaw, and I urge that we do it here. Part of the reason I believe why it may be in the charter with respect to the ZBA is that there is state law that governs zoning boards of appeal, and that state law specifically provides for associate members. In fact, that state law specifically also provides that those associate members may vote in certain circumstances. I point out, by the way, for all of our consideration, there is no prohibition to permitting associate members from voting in any other instances other than instances where a regular member is not present, and I myself am in favor of that. And I see no reason why others ought not be in favor of that as well. However, with respect to the ZBA, the state statute specifically provides that associate members may step up in the absence or inability of a full member. I would like to point out there was much discussion yesterday, seems like so long ago, or only earlier this morning, I'm not sure. There was much discussion about the rationale for this provision that I am urging we strike. One of which, or the only one of which, is this concern about an appointment at the 11th hour of a so-called ringer, and that ought not happen. I would just like to point out two important reasons why I think that is not a valid reason. I would like to point out to town meeting that in addition to the ZBA, there is state law that governs local governments establishing historic commissions, historical commissions as well. And that state law, which I believe is Chapter 40, Section 8, D, specifically also, in addition to enabling localities to establish housing authorities, I point out, by the way, it states that the housing, the historical commissions shall consist of no less than 3 members and no more than 7. And I would therefore suggest that getting back to 4.8, that leaving it at the pleasure, at the discretion of the selectmen, arguably contravenes that state law. But I'll get at that at another time. But that state law that enables historical commissions providing for no less than 3 and no more than 7 also provides for associate members. It refers to them as alternate members in the statute. But I believe that there has been some discussion between historical commission representatives, town council, and including town manager and town moderator, in which town council suggests that reference in the statute establishing associate members, which calls them alternate members, is intended to address not just alternate members, but in fact associate members. So I simply want to point out that similar to the ZBA legislation, state legislation, and therefore inclusion in the charter of a reference to the associate members in the charter for the ZBA, there is a state law, Chapter 40, Section 8D, which also provides for the establishment of historical commissions and the creation of associate positions. So I would suggest it also, that state law providing for associate historical commission members specifically states that in the absence or unavailability of the regular member, that associate member shall step up to fulfill the responsibilities of the full member. So I would submit to you that if we do not strike this provision that would disable associate members from voting in either 90 days or 100 days or for any period, that is in direct contravention of that state law. I would also submit that the rationale, another reason why the rationale to avoid ringers being appointed by the Board of Selectmen at the 11th hour is invalid because that same state law provides that in the event of the unavailability or absence of a full member, the associate member shall step up to fulfill those responsibilities, and that state law specifically says that associate member shall be designated not by the Board of Selectmen, but by the chair of the Historical Commission. So presuming we have associate members, and presuming that there is a number of them, the likelihood of the number of them all being appointed at the 11th hour is a little bit unrealistic. So I would submit to you that if there are associate members and if there is an unavailability of a full member, there is no eventuality where a selectman can put in a ringer because the determination of who will be designated from among the associate members is solely at the authority of the chair. So for all of those reasons, I strongly support this amendment to strike that provision. Thank you. I would like the opportunity to address Section 4.8 at an appropriate time.
Right, right now, we're speaking on those amendments.
Understand. Thank you.
Yes. Mr. Meares.
Just so we're all clear, the charter is different from a bylaw. Everybody pretty well understands that if you have a bylaw that is in conflict with a statute, that the statute rules over the bylaw. The opposite is true with respect to a charter provision. So a charter provision that conflicts with state law supersedes the state law. It's not in conflict with the state law. It's not illegal. It supersedes the state law.
Ms. Binder?
What if charter provisions of charter conflict with other provisions of the charter? Then which one rules?
Mr. Meares?
Of course, that can't possibly happen. obviously sometimes it turns out that things that we thought were perfectly compatible seem in a particular circumstance to be incompatible. The rule of statutory construction is that we devise an interpretation of the two provisions so that they are not in conflict.
So under, I think it's 4.8, it says the Historical Commission is established according to Mass General Law 40D, and this conflicts with the other part of it.
What it actually says is that they will have the rights and responsibilities of historical commissions as established by 40D. It doesn't mean that they are, that their procedures are governed by 40D or that their appointment process is governed by 40D.
So it says it has the rights and responsibilities?
I could look up what it says, okay. But it's something like that, yes.
So my question is, if this says associate members are not, and 4.8 says that the Historical Commission is established under 40D and it has the rights and responsibilities, which one would govern?
When you say are not what?
Well, if we don't strike this.
Yes.
And this is adopted under 90 or 180 days, but 4.8 states that the Historical Commission has the rights and responsibilities under Mass General Law, which one of those would govern?
Both. One? They're not inconsistent.
How are they not inconsistent?
The Historic Commission doesn't have the right to supersede. They have the right to exercise the authority of a historical commission, but that doesn't. Their procedures are governed by the charter. So one's substantive, one's procedural.
Okay. So then I hope that people support Mr. Barnes. I also, I think that associate members should have the right. I think with speaking with Mr. Brown, there was a lot of discussion about this. He was on the charter committee. He has proposed striking this section. There are times I'm offended by the idea that associate members might step in for nefarious reasons. I think that there are times when all the committees in the past few years, there have been openings. We need members. We sometimes need members to step in. The idea that someone would be stepping in for nefarious reason. I know there are a lot of associate members. George Katsoufis on the CPDC, I think he's been there forever. He's one of the most qualified members. They're all qualified in the CPDC. They do a wonderful job. But he's no less qualified than the other members to make a vote. And Mr. Barnes is an associate member. There are a lot of extremely qualified associate members, so I support Mr. Barnes's and Mr. Brown's amendment.
I saw a hand up in the aisle. Yes. I assume you're moving the question on those particular amendments? Yes. We have a motion to move the question on those three, the last three amendments. Do I have the counters that I asked from last week? I don't think I do.
We're all down front.
But they're all down, well, I can't count those, yeah. Let's see. Well, Mr. Lippitt, would you take the right and the Board of Selectmen? Ms. Folds, would you take the right of the wire? And who did I have do Mr. Doxer, would you do the honors? And let's see, over on the left, Mr. Graham, yes, good. Mr. Graham, would you take the left? I don't think there's anybody down in front of you. Okay, all those in favor of ending debate on those last three amendments, please rise.
Twenty-one.
Those opposed?
Two.
Zero.
Three.
Zero and three. And what was this last one, Mr. Doxer? I missed the fourth. What was yours? Three. Okay. Vote being 96 in the affirmative. We're missing a number. Could I ask? We seem to only have three numbers. So I'm not sure which one we're missing. You were three. You were one. Three and one.
Zero.
312. And what was yours?
Zero.
3120. 96-6. The motion carries. So we will now proceed to the Fifth Amendment, the amendment that Mr. Brown made, in the box. All those in favor of that? Can we get it highlighted? Oh, you are. Okay.
You also need that blue box.
Is that correct? Have you got it right?
Yeah.
I can't really see it from here. That whole sentence? Okay. We will be. The motion is to strike that sentence. Everything in blue. The whole sentence, yes. Point of order? No, not in this particular amendment. Now, if this should pass, I believe that precludes the need for the second, the fourth and third. Think about that for a second. Yes, it does. Okay. Okay, so are we all set? Everybody know what we're voting for?
No.
We're voting to remove everything that's in blue right now. Which also includes that green piece in the middle? The whole sentence.
Is it blue? Blue and
green.
Yes.
Blue and green.
It's a sentence that's blue and I guess it's green too. And
you got it? So it's a sentence that starts with in no case.
And ends with?
Otherwise present.
Right here.
Otherwise present. Point of order? Would somebody who can see the screen, would you read what we're removing?
Okay.
Okay.
The sentence.
Mr. Lalash,
you want to read it, Bob?
You got to read the unamended version.
The unamended version.
Forget all those other proposed amendments.
So what and I'm not
the
sure
amendment
exactly
is
what
to remove the piece in blue and green. That's what we're asking to vote.
Let me try.
Yeah.
The motion on the floor would ignore any other amendment that has been suggested, which is still shown up there, otherwise I'm going to lose my mind. So it would be to delete, in no case, may an associate member vote on an issue if he has served an associate member for less than 180 days following his initial appointment, except as allowed by Massachusetts general laws. That all goes away.
That's a different
That's
amendment.
A separate amendment.
It's a separate motion.
We have three that we're about to vote on. Although if this first one passes, that would preclude the need for the other two. All right, everybody clear what you're voting on? No? Mr. Struble?
Just to be very clear, I remember Mr. Brown, when he made this motion, said that he wanted to get rid of the periwinkle color, the single sentence, but keep the light blue in the top, which is if specified by the charter, town bylaw, Massachusetts general laws. Is that correct?
That is not part of this motion.
We want to keep that in there. You're keeping that. So this vote is just getting rid of that single sentence in the middle in the dark blue.
Correct. The one Thank that you. Bob just read. Everybody all set?
Pretty cool.
Any questions? All right. All those in favor of that proposed amendment, please raise your hand. Those opposed? And the motion carries. Okay. We are now back into discussion, but what I would like to do now is to go back and discuss the other two proposed amendments we had on associate membership, one made by Mr. Ensminger and one made by Mr. Sasso, which I have lost track of. Mr. Sasso's is removing the light blue at the top.
Is that correct?
Okay, and then Mr. Ensminger is the yellow at the end.
Which one are we voting
yes.
on?
So we will vote on Mr. Sasso's first.
And that should preclude.
Yes. Okay, so Mr. Sasso's is the light blue at the top. Could we have somebody read that? Just so we know for clarity what we are removing. The words are, if specified in the charter, town bylaw, or Massachusetts general laws. Everybody clear what we're voting on? We're voting to remove that line. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed? Motion does not carry. Question the count? Okay. I'll ask the same counters. All those in favor of that motion, please rise. We had the count was questioned, so we are now taking a standing count. If you are in favor of this motion, please rise. Striking the light blue at the top.
Three?
Four.
Five?
Eight.
And those opposed to striking that line. I didn't hear that, I'm sorry.
24.
18.
21.
18.
The vote being 20 in the affirmative, 81 in the negative, the motion does not carry. We will now move to Mr. Ensminger's motion, which is removing everything in yellow from associate members down to first.
Adding.
Is that correct?
Adding.
Adding, yes. I'm sorry.
Sorry.
Okay, we all clear on that? All right. All those in favor of adding everything that's in yellow, please raise your hand. Those opposed? And I haven't got a question that count. All those in favor, please rise.
Seventeen.
11.
19.
And those opposed? We have point of order.
It's a process question. I wonder if it's possible to recognize people only one time in each section as opposed to recognizing the same person multiple times. Given that we're 50 minutes through and we have only debated this one section.
Yeah, point well taken. We will try to do that moving forward, except where we're looking to answer questions. Okay, I'm sorry. Where are we? This is the
Six.
No vote. Six?
Four.
Four?
Five.
Five?
12.
The vote being 67 in the affirmative, 27 in the negative, the motion carries. All right, we are back into discussion of the, Section 4, Charter Article 4 with no amendments in front of us right now. Further discussion? Mr. Donnelly Moran.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Charles Donnelly Moran, Precinct 7. In Section 4.9, Housing Authority.
I don't think we changed any of that, do we?
So the original charter was changed to add the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, which we've been doing all along. But then they also added the Department of Housing and Community Development, which was not in the original charter. And that is the state agency that actually issues the notice to the Housing Authority. But the commissioner is actually the governor's appointee. And that state agencies change. When I first started working for a housing authority a number of years ago, the agency that we dealt with was the Executive Office of Communities and Development, and now it's the Department of Housing and Community Development. There have been proposals to change the who's in charge of housing authorities, so having a department that, you know, in 10 years may no longer exist seems unnecessary. So I'm proposing eliminating Department of Housing and Community Development.
Okay, you make a motion to
yes, please.
Department of Housing and okay. Is there a second? Second. Further discussion? Mr. Brown?
I believe in the back of the charter someplace it says that with the name change, the law stays the same, essentially. So it makes no difference one way or the other. It doesn't affect the bylaw.
Right, and right after Department of Housing and Community Development, it says, or as otherwise provided.
Yeah.
But it's unnecessary that will have to be changed
I
in the future.
I agree.
Further discussion on the proposed amendment? None appearing. Are we ready for the vote? All those in favor of the proposed amendment, please raise your hand. Those opposed? And the motion carries. Further discussion under Section 4, Article Charter Article 4. Mr. Barnes?
Speak now, forever hold the peace.
Well, thank you, Mr. Moderator. Jonathan Barnes, Precinct 5. As I said, I apologize to the extent that this may further discussion at town meeting. I'm aware we have other important business, but it strikes me that all sections are important, and this is important to me as a town meeting member, and I believe to other town meeting members. So I ask your indulgence for just a few minutes. You had rendered a ruling concerning an effort to amend 4.8 on the Historical Commission section yesterday. And you had suggested that you thought it was outside of the bounds of what was the subject of discussion,
correct?
And I would simply like to have a moment to ask for your reconsideration of that. And I'd like to mention briefly several reasons why I think that should be entertained. Number one, you had suggested that, I believe after hearing from some members of the commission, that there already was a reference in the existing charter, and that this was simply transposing the language to another section. I don't believe that is accurate, and I would just like to, if I may. I'm gonna quote from the existing section of the charter, 4.10, other committees. The selectmen shall appoint the following committees and determine the number of members and their term of appointment not to exceed 3 years, A, Town Forest Committee, B, Historical Commission, period. In the it has that same provision, but it has a second paragraph. And that second paragraph I would submit for your consideration is a new paragraph and did not exist in the previous or the current iteration. And it says, The Historical Commission shall have all the powers and duties granted by historical commissions by the Massachusetts General Laws, and such additional powers and duties as may be provided by the Charter, by town bylaw, or by town meeting vote. So I submit to you that it isn't exactly the same. It is different additional language. And for that reason, it is not simply or merely transposing one or two sentences to another section. It is, in fact, adding another section. I would also like to assert, second, some additional information which I think is relevant for this, for you, and certainly for town meeting's consideration. Although there is no bylaw establishing the Historical Commission, interestingly, there was a prior vote of town meeting on November 14th in 1977, which has been brought to my attention, and I'd like to bring it to your attention and to the attention of town meeting members. And I'll quote from that Article 9 in November of 1977. On motion of Richard J. Ogden, as amended by Joyce K. Miller, it was voted that the town of Reading establish an historical commission for the purpose of identifying and recording historic assets of the town and for developing and implementing a program for their preservation, and such commission to be composed of 5 members appointed by the Board of Selectmen for terms of 3 years, except that the initial appointment shall be 1 member for 1 year, 2 members for 2 years, and 2 members for 3 years. So I simply want to point out, I think that it is relevant for purposes of this deliberation and for our deliberation. I do not know why the current charter merely says what it says, but I think it is significant for our consideration and therefore ought to be subject for discussion here at town meeting. That this town meeting or its predecessor in 1977 specifically voted and directed that there shall be 5 members appointed by the Board of Selectmen. I think that's obviously at odds from the current charter and that ought to be rectified. Third, as I pointed out before, there is in fact a state law. And although town council has corrected me that if we decide to do otherwise in the charter, that will supersede the state statute. But I would suggest that A, there is a state statute that provides not for the designation at the sole discretion of the members of the Historical Commission at the sole discretion of the Board of Selectmen, but rather the state legislature has said that the Historical Commission shall be composed of no less than 3, no more than 7. And again, I believe it is inconsistent. The current charter language is inconsistent with the state statute, and for those reasons, I think it may be that town meeting could choose to have a charter language that differs, and that would supersede. But I would submit that we ought to ask the question why we would want to do that. So for those reasons, I think it is worthy to entertain discussion about this particular provision. Thank you.
Just to reiterate why I made the decision I made, to explain a little bit, when we're making these charter changes, we can only affect what the proposals are. Now, I understand this is a little trickier than the others, where we did move it to another spot and add some language. My feeling last night when I made that ruling, and I tend to still believe it, is they were just cosmetic changes. If for some reason you wanted to move to strike the new line, I suppose that would be legitimate. Now, I would ask if the town council feels that they are more than cosmetic, I will reconsider that ruling. But the way I feel it is, it feels like it's just cosmetic changes.
And may I suggest, I obviously defer to you and the town council, but I would suggest the added language specifically says the Historical Commission shall have all powers and duties granted by the Mass General Laws, and such additional powers and duties as may be provided, et cetera, et cetera. That is not simply cosmetic. That is a direct reference to Mass General Laws, and therefore I think it is more than cosmetic.
Well, thank you. I'll await your opinion. Mr. Meares?
Okay, so Section 4.8 has 2 paragraphs. The paragraph that we were talking about yesterday when we were talking about it being cosmetic is the first paragraph, which says there'll be a historical commission appointed by the Board of Selectmen, shall determine the number of members and their term of appointment not to exceed 3 years. All of that's in the existing charter in a different form. That's what's cosmetic. So essentially that's no change, it's just moving it to a different section. The second paragraph is indeed something new. Okay, now where we are now is we have dealt with associate members. We've gotten rid of the 180-day waiting period for voting. The provision that we have arrived at says that there will be associate members if they are provided for in the charter, if they are provided for in a bylaw, or if they are provided for in state law. You correctly point out that there is a provision in state law that talks about alternate members, but I think that it's fair to read that section to refer to what we're calling associate members. That provision calls for those alternate members to be appointed by the Board of Selectmen, so that's consistent with what we've got here. And it allows the chair to designate one or more of those associate members to vote in any particular circumstance when they're needed. That's where we are.
I agree, but with all due respect, the question is whether we can entertain a motion to amend that section.
To amend the first paragraph? No. To amend the second paragraph? Sure.
Again, it is not my intention to beat this to death, but I do think it's an important point. We're sort of splitting hairs here. What I would have suggested, if I were permitted to amend the first section, I will present it as an amendment, as a motion to amend the second, is to simply add a reference to there being consistent with the town meeting vote of 1977 and consistent with the longstanding past practice. I would simply move to amend that there be a reference to there being five members. And in light of the discussion that I've already entertained thus far about the associate members and the recognition that it's permitted, I would be moving to add consisting of five members and five associate members. I would have proposed that we add it to the first paragraph, but if I'm not permitted to move that, then I would add that it be added to the second paragraph.
Excuse me, you have a point of order? I think he is trying to figure out a way of amending the second piece. I think that's why I'm interpreting what you're talking about.
I did not say, with all due respect, that I don't have the power. I believe town council just indicated that we can offer motions to amend the second paragraph. That's what I'm seeking to do, unfortunately, because my preference would be to amend the first paragraph. So I'm therefore proposing to amend the second paragraph.
Mr. Miaris?
Okay. When I say you can't amend the first paragraph, but you can amend the second paragraph, I don't mean that you can amend the second paragraph to contradict the first. The provisions of the first paragraph are not within the four corners. That's what the moderator has ruled. So, putting it in the second paragraph and contradicting the first is similarly out of order.
That's
touché. Thank you.
I needed your advice, but yes, that is what I felt. Mr. Brown?
The reason that the second in there is that so every appointed body has the same consistency, Mass General Laws, etc. In fact, if you think you go back to the 10 years ago when we made the thing, at my mistake, we put in by the Constitution, and they're not covered by the Constitution of Massachusetts. It's only four boards that are. Thank you.
Mr. Arena? Well, it's 10 minutes. But again, I'll remind people we're under a tight deadline tonight. Did I have another hand? I'm sorry. Yes, Mr. Berman?
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Barry Berman, Precinct 4. If I remember correctly, yesterday from the discussion,
The reason why the Charter Review Committee suggested to put in reference to the Town Forest Committee and the Historical Committee is to basically elevate those committees because of their enhanced importance and value to the town. Basically, the things that have been going through those committees are valuable. So the whole point of putting it in the Charter was basically to show that, yes, we think this is important. The last speaker and ones before seemed to suggest that that there's the potential of diminishing, that the selectmen will have the powers to diminish those committees by not having the proper number of members. So my suggestion would be if those folks are worried about that, that they would make an amendment that basically just gets rid of 8 and 10, and they'll just exist as they do currently. But I think the whole point of what the Charter Review Committee did was to elevate the importance of this. So I don't think there's that this Board of Selectmen or future Boards of Selectmen are going to do anything to diminish those powers. So if the intent is to try to protect the way those committees do business now, just make an amendment to get rid of them out of this Charter, and they'll just exist as they do currently. And if not, let's just move on. Thank you.
Mr. Crook?
Stephen Crook, Precinct 2. One way that the prior speaker might get around his issue, his concern seems to be he wants to keep the five members as town meeting voted in 1977, would be to offer an instructional motion to this body to instruct the bylaw committee to insert a bylaw that required five members for the Historic Commission, or whatever number of members he felt was appropriate. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Further discussion? Point of order.
If my understanding is correct from town council that the charter supersedes, although that was about state law, I would be curious what town council would say about a bylaw which authorizes or designates five members as compared to a charter provision which leaves the number up to the selectmen.
Mr. Meares?
The charter takes priority over the bylaw, as you correctly suggested. So if the charter says the number is determined by the Board of Selectmen, a bylaw that says something different would be inconsistent with the charter.
So then we can't amend the bylaw or create a bylaw to establish five with this provision in there, is that correct?
No. The provision in the charter says that the number will be determined by the Board of Selectmen. It would take some clever drafting to write a bylaw that reins that in, but it might be possible to do it.
Thank you.
Further discussion? Oh, I'm sorry, Mr. Carpenter. I'm sorry, I can't hear you if you use the microphone. Okay. Further discussion? All right. We have an amendment. Yeah, we will move on to section five.
Great. Okay.
Wait a second. Do we have a point of order? Do we have an amendment? Oh, did we not vote on Mr. We did. We voted on that. Removing the HUD. Yes, we've moved on from section four to section five, charter article five, excuse me. Okay, Mr. Brown?
Okay, thank you. We're finally there. My favorite subject, the town manager. I like to beat up on him. If the first one is 5.1, we just rearranged some of the seating on it, and the last paragraph was moved from the back end up to the front. We felt it was a more appropriate place to be. And that's his determination. It was further down on the agenda, but we felt it would better tie it at that end. Anything else is really not that much. Now, 5.2, I guess it's small letter B. We added the words to allow the town manager to appoint the appraiser, which we already voted the other evening. There's no substantive changes there. On little K, we added the word or designee, and this relates to the maintenance of buildings. We don't want Bob up there sweeping the buildings. I think he's underqualified, but this allows him to have the maintenance department, the facilities department, to do the building. That's basically what that is. And then the next one down is the section, little n, 5.2n. We added the words to serve as chief procurement officer pursuant to the provisions of Chapter 30 Mass General Laws to make it clear who does the purchasing. And the exemption for the school department and the light department remain in the thing. And if any of you ever watched MASH, the chief procurement officer, for, I'm sure his wife will be careful of what he procures. And then the next one is the ombudsman, 5.3. We made somebody else the ombudsman other than the town manager. We felt that if you had a gripe with the town manager, you're going to go to him to find out he's not going to do anything about it. So he's going to appoint somebody else to do that. And for you that have been in the military, you know if you got a good gripe about the CO, you can go to the chaplain. Might not do you any good, but that's what you can go to. And he's going to appoint a town employee to do that. And in the charter, it says it has to be conspicuously marked. I haven't found it in town hall yet, since the charter's been there. Acting town manager, 5.5. We increased his temporary absence from 10 days to 30 days. When you stop and think about it, if he goes on vacation, as it is presently now, he's going to have to write three letters and come back and appoint somebody. We felt it was better to allow him to have the 30 days. And we also put a limit of 30 days without reappointment by the Board of Selectmen. We figured that was good. And we also increased the power of the acting town manager to allow him, by a 4/5 vote of the Board of Selectmen, to take care of any emergency situation that may come up. Presently, under the charter, the acting town manager can only take care of routine maintenance. Let's say something happens that's not covered by the emergency management, such as a water tower falls down. Do we have to wait till the town manager comes back? I don't think so. And for you that may not realize it, but under the open meeting laws, the selectman could, in fact, call an emergency meeting and post it afterwards. And with remote participation now, I don't have any problems with trying to get the 4/5 vote. So, and that about covers it on five. I don't think there's too much else that's been changed.
Okay, further discussion? Mr. Donnelly Moran, was he? No? Oh, I thought you were. Okay. Mr. D'Addario.
Well, thank you, Mr. Moderator. Ron D'Addario, Precinct 6. I just had a question for sort of the town manager. I noticed in 5.2B, Bob, I noticed that apparently you don't have control of personnel who are under the school committee, the light board, or the board of library trustees. So I'm just wondering, in 5.2N, now here you don't have responsibility for supplies for the school committee or again the municipal light board, would it be best for you also not to have the responsibility of materials for the board of for the library? And I say that only because you don't have control of the personnel.
My understanding of what this means as a practical matter, Mass General Law is very specific on the role of the Chief Procurement Officer. The dollar level changes over time. It's $25,000 and up. So as a practical matter, the town manager does have last word, if you will, on a school expense of larger than $25,000 a contract. But this town manager has no interest in a $500 item from any one of those departments. As a practical matter, we have our own procurement system in place. Department heads are the last word for a certain dollar threshold and below. And that's working fine. So the language in the charter is consistent with how we're doing it now. The actual change to the use of the term chief procurement officer is simply putting that word in for the duties that are already being done.
Further discussion? Mr. Berman?
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Barry Berman, Precinct 4. Under the ombudsman, it's clear that the intent of drafting this language is to make sure that there's someone else other than the town manager that would act in the function in that role of ombudsman. But as it's written here, or as you suggested to be written here, it says the town manager shall appoint a town employee to act as an ombudsman, but the town manager is an employee, so that doesn't prohibit this language does not prohibit the town manager from appointing himself. So I would just like to make an amendment to simply add that the town manager shall appoint a town employee other than himself to act. Unless I'm reading this wrong.
Because I've got it in my copy.
Okay, is there a second?
Second.
Okay. Further discussion? We'll stick to this amendment until we've disposed of it. Further discussion on his amendment? Oh, I'm sorry.
Ann Landry, Precinct 5. Just in keeping with our conversation yesterday about gender neutrality in the language, maybe I'd like to offer a friendly amendment such that it would say him or herself.
Okay, any objection to that being part of the motion? None appearing, it would be him or herself. Further discussion on the proposed amendment? We'll take a vote. All those in favor of the amendment, please raise your hand. Those opposed? And the motion carries. Further discussion in this section. Mr. McKenzie.
Yeah, very quickly, Bruce McKenzie, Precinct 8. I think you omitted the word committee in this when you intended to change it to boards and committees. So section 3.B, the town clerk has the wording. Add the word committee so it reads directors, comma, department heads, comma, boards, comma, or committees. And also 5.3, second line, minor grammar, to read town, comma, its officials, comma, boards, comma, and committees. I don't want to take time to discuss it.
Okay. Is that...
That's acceptable.
Okay, so you want to add the word... We may just take a quick vote because it's a committee. We can't really accept the thing. So, or committees. So the...
If it takes too long to type it, you can go on to another comment.
Okay. Let's get it up there before we take a vote. Did you have two or... Did you have two spots? Oh, I see. 5.3B and then 5.3 second line. So add the word committees, remove and... add or so that it reads directors, department heads, boards, or committees. That's on B.
I'm sorry, I gave you a sheet ahead of time to try to make it clear. under B, department heads, comma, boards, comma, or committees.
Right.
So, okay, so strike the word and right where the cursor is.
We want and boards or committees. The reason is boards or committees is something that's defined in the back that encompasses all multi-member bodies. Mr. Meares, did you want to, maybe you can make it clearer.
So we were playing with the term multi-member bodies for a long time, and we hated it. And it conjures up strange images and whatever. So we decided to get rid of it and to use boards or committees as the term. It's a defined term. So in this case, since we, you're absolutely right that it should say boards or committees, but boards or committees is a single thing, so and boards or committees is the proper
just
construction.
Trying to fix grammar in the interest of time, I withdraw it.
You withdraw it? Okay. It actually was probably, is a good idea. I think we're trying to fix your proposed amendment. I think you have caught a mistake, but the problem is boards or committees is a defined single entity. So we want to use the word and boards or committees. If that's acceptable to your proposed amendment. Okay. And Mr. Greenfield makes the motions with the boards or committees. Okay.
Okay, people in the future will be reading this and they won't know about multi-member bodies. They won't know.
It is defined in the document.
The words and or ors.
It's so actually defined in the definitions, boards or committees, to mean all any multi-member body. We need to move on here. Do you want to make the motion? If not, I think Mr. Greenfield will.
Okay. Go ahead.
Yeah. Mr. Greenfield, you want to? Yeah.
They forget the old high ground. Jesus.
David Greenfield, Precinct 5. Yes, I'd like to keep that language in order to stay consistent with the definition and the use throughout the document.
Okay. Boards or committees. And boards or committees.
Yes.
Yes. Okay. Is there a second? Second. Okay. Discussion on that proposed amendment. None appearing. All those in favor? All those opposed? And the motion carries. Further discussion in this section?
Did we vote on other than himself? Okay.
Yes. We voted. Yes. Yeah. Okay. Any further discussion in this section? None appearing. We will now move on to section 6, which I believe is Mr. Struble.
Mr. Moderator.
Yes, Mr. Brown.
For you that have been around town long enough, I don't know if you ever remember Bruce Morang's Hydra, all the boards and bodies, and that's why we went to boards and committees.
All right. Jeff Struble, a member of the Charter Review Committee. We're doing Article 6. Chapter by chapter, 6.1, if anybody understands what the administrative code, please raise your hand. We scratched our heads on this for a while, not knowing exactly what it was supposed to mean. And we think it may have something to do historical, but nonetheless, what is its point? And we think that the main reason for it is to essentially be illustrative of how town government is organized and how to essentially publish that and display it. And we thought that the table of organization, that flowchart you've seen, which has literally a flowchart with departments going down different things, was the way to go. And that's why we essentially reduced all the administrative code to the table of organization and allowed it to be, or more or less demanded that it be presented every year as a part of the budget message, which is section, I think, 7.4. You'll see that when we get there. But that is what the revision to 6.1 was. We tried to simplify it very much, got rid of almost a page, and made the table, the, t- the uh, table organization, essentially the point of information. If anyone wants to know how town government is organized, that's where you go. 6.2. Town council, we did sort of get rid of the word yearly so that he can act longer, and really just took all his supposed or intended duties and put it into a very concise statement, and that's the major change to 6.2. 6.3, we did put in a provision for a vacancy, also in town council as well. Once we thought everyone should have a provision for a vacancy, and that you'll see that reappearing in many of these positions that we're describing in this section. Just the same with town the town accountant. I think I may be going too fast. Not a good, bad idea at this point. okay. 6.4 and 6.5 are kind of joined. 6.4. There used to be a combination of town treasurer dash collector. Now there's a separate section for each, 6.4 and 6.5. I guess that's what the reality is now, but we left the provision in that they could be recombined I think it's 6.5, yeah, that it could be recombined at the town manager's request to the Board of Selectmen. So it's to, I guess, reflect reality, but also not give up the possibility that they could be recombined. This is sort of unusual. 6.6, there never was any provision for a town clerk or any definition of what town clerk's position and duties in the charter, which we thought was unusual. We thought it should be in there, even though state statutes require it, and that's why we've always had one. We thought that to be consistent with the town organization, that the position of town clerk should be codified essentially in the charter, and that's what 6.6 is about. Really, it defers mainly just to, if you read the requirements, it defers to Mass General laws, but also provides for a vacancy if needed. So that, in a nutshell, is what Chapter 6 was about.
Discussion on Chapter 6?
Oh, come on.
Oh, yes, on the aisle.
Mr. Moderator.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Karen Burke, Precinct 2. Can you explain why the accountant is appointed annually and none of the other positions have that provision? And also, some of them specify term of office, accountant and town clerk, but treasurer and collector don't. They just talk about appointment and qualification. Thank you.
Mr. Struble.
Bob, can you answer that?
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. In terms of the accountant, the reason why that was appointed is basically to make that sort of a direct report to the Board of Selectmen in case there is some issue that needs to be brought to their attention. That's the reason why that is appointed.
Is there a hand over here? Yes. Mr. Doxer.
Mark Doxer, Precinct 1. Just a quick question. Maybe if you can. Oh, sorry.
I don't think that was a full answer, and Bob was going to give her the rest of it. Can you wait a minute?
Oh, would you mind waiting just a second, Mr. Doxer? Sorry. Okay, Mr. LaLasha.
Thank you, Ms. Moderator. I think the first speaker raises a good point on the town clerk. I think that's just an oversight. There's no reason why it should say term of office. It should be consistent with treasurer and collector before that. So I would suggest an amendment to strike that bolded thing behind me.
Okay, before we do that, I'll call on Mr. Doxer.
Yeah. Quick question. I'm wondering if Mark Doxer, Precinct 1, is it possible just to elaborate a little bit in the former 6.3 on public works? Just trying to figure out kind of why.
Well, I'm sorry, I should have mentioned that. It was in my notes and I glossed over it. There was, at one point, the director of public works was elected. And this is And there was a board that was elected as well. So this is, that was probably carried over from the transition section. We've already made the transition, so we got rid of it because there's no need for it.
Did we have someone that was going to make a proposed amendment over here? Oh, what was the motion? I did not. Strike the word term of office. Hold on a second, did you get that? Okay. All right, is there a second to that motion? Second. Any discussion on the proposed amendment? None appearing. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed? Motion carries. More business under Article 6, Charter Article 6? None appearing. We'll move on to Section 7.
All right.
Charter Article 7.
You notice the name changed of Article 7 to start to reflect the what's in it. Instead of finances and fiscal procedures, it's budget and capital improvements. There's really no substantive changes until you get down to 7.3, in which we've added, I guess, the provision that the school committee's budget be submitted at least 5 months before the start of the fiscal year, which would be, I think, February 1st, I remember, which is to be consistent with all the other agencies. Previously, it had been just sufficient time, which was sort of indistinct, and the town manager has requested that for everyone's planning purposes, that if there is a deadline that everyone holds to, it would make life easier. So we agreed to put that in. Regarding 7.4, again, talking about the table of organization, it's now going to be presented as part of the budget message every year. And if it needs to be changed, that will be brought up at that time. So that's pretty much the main, and also the language is being cleaned up. Section 7.5, Ronald Reagan would be proud of us. We've added the little provision that the all town funds and activities shall be balanced to the funds available. That essentially ensures a balanced budget. It has been essentially adopted by convention, but has never been codified specifically. We thought it was necessary, or at least advisable, to put it in the charter as chapter and verse, and there it is. 7.6, there was, I guess, down to 7.6.4, I guess a holdover that the Finance Committee never had to report for anything under $500. It sort of never happens, and it seemed kind of useless, so we got rid of it, and that's the main thing for 7.6. 7.7, capital improvements program has been widely disseminated in this, and that's reflects in the change of the name of the article itself, mainly just word changes. Excuse me as I flip the page. Oops. Yeah. 7.8 and 7.9 were eliminated. The 7.9 has been moved to the town manager's duties on 5.2.16. So that's pretty much the revisions to Article 7.
Discussion on Charter Article 7. Yes.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Tony DiRezzo, Precinct 2. In Section 7.2, I would like to remove the amendment to remove the word of after local medium, where it says publication in a local news medium of a general summary. That's just a kind of a, I don't know where the of came from, but it's a awkward phrasing. The same phrase is also used in 7.61.
So you're asking to remove the word. Is there a second to that?
I would ask the grammarians in the audience to check that.
Any comments on it? Do we have a second, first of all? Second. Do we have any discussion on that? Mr. Alasher?
I'm the worst grammarian in the room, but I don't understand what the sentence would mean without the word of.
Mr. Tuttle?
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Dave Tuttle, Precinct 3. I believe that the intent of the amendment would be better served by inserting a comma after publication and after medium. Say publication, comma, in a local news medium, comma, of a general summary.
Do we have such an amendment?
I would consider that friendly.
Okay, as who made the,
yes, I will consider that a friendly amendment.
I'm sorry, I could not hear you.
Yes, I will consider that a friendly amendment.
Okay, all right, so the amendment now reads, adding the two commas, it does not remove the word of. Is that correct?
Correct.
Okay. Okay, no objection to that change? Ms. Binda, do you have an objection or do you have a comment?
If you add the two commas, then you need to take out the of, because if you take out the clause, it would be, he shall simultaneously provide a general summary. So the two commas create a clause. So the commas are appropriate, but the of is inappropriate.
Correct. You're correct.
So
yes.
With the commas, you still
also
need to take
the
out the of.
Yes, you're absolutely correct. Yeah.
I think it reads better.
Again, no, is that friendly amendment? Okay. Okay. Further discussion on that? Yes. No. Okay. Mr. Lasher, did you have a comment?
My apologies, but I still won't know what to do unless the of is there. You do provide a summary, but you don't provide for the publication a summary.
We have a hand up in the back. Ms. Schneider.
Gina Schneider, Precinct 5. Maybe you should just move in a local news medium to the end. And then you keep the whole thing together of what he has to provide for publication of, and then say where at the end.
Accept it as a friendly amendment.
Well, let's look at it. Mr. Mayor,
I'm sorry. This is my handiwork. If you move it all the way to the end, I'm afraid it will be more confusing still. Because you have this notice stating the times. So if you put it at the end, it would not be clear that the summary would have to be in a local news medium. It would only suggest that only the notice has to be in the local news medium. I think it's really best where it is. I like the commas, but I think it really needs to be that way.
So, excuse me, what were you suggesting that we do? Leave it as is?
Well, put the commas.
Mostly I'm just apologizing because I wrote a really bad sentence. But I'm hoping not to make it worse by moving the phrase to the end, which will make it not only long and hard to understand, but ambiguous.
So you're suggesting that we put the commas in? How about the of? Leave the of in. Now we have to go back to our original mover. What is that your intention?
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. I believe the problem with the sentence was simply that you have a preposition phrase in a preposition phrase. The in a local medium of applies to both, and therefore you could remove the of. If it makes everybody's life easier, I will simply withdraw the amendment and we can move on.
Okay, I think we will withdraw it. Further discussion? Mr. Doxson?
Thank Moderator. Mark Doxer, Precinct 1. In 7.5, do we either have or need a definition of funds available? In other words, we go to great lengths in budget articles, warrant articles, to talk about raised by tax levy, borrowing, and other resources. And I just want to make sure that we don't run into a situation of, does funds available mean sitting in free cash? Does it mean, you know, what does it mean?
Mr. LaLasher?
This was just put in here for the future nefarious town manager. It's state law that says this body has to pass a balanced budget, but there is nowhere in state law that says the town manager must submit to you a balanced budget. So, as a practical matter, it seems like I should, because otherwise we'll be here all night, or obviously through FinCom. So funds available, quite honestly, is as decided by FinCom, because FinCom is the ultimate arbiter of what that is. And the current practice is the town accountant suggests what the revenues are. There's a discussion, a full discussion with many boards and committees, but the town accountant really, if you will, through the Chinese wall, is the final word on revenues. And those are the funds available. Then FinCom steps in and says, well, in addition to those funds, we're willing to spend some free cash. So that becomes the new funds available. I don't see any need to define that any more than it is. It's kind of a generally accepted phrase as to, well, how much money do we have to spend? And you hopefully will have a town manager that understands what that means.
Further discussion? Mr. Berman.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Barry Berman, Precinct 4. Under 7.4, under the budget message, I'm curious as to why the last few sentences, in blue in the summary, were omitted. It seems that those are all perfectly reasonable things that the town manager should outline for town meeting on what the budget should have. Fiscal policies, variances from budget year over year, summarizing our debt position, and other things. It just seems that it's not superfluous, and in fact, it's actually that what a budget message should include. So I'm wondering why that was taken out.
Mr. LaLasher?
Actually, I was thinking about this as we discussed it a few months ago. I don't think any town manager, to my knowledge, has ever summarized the debt position for this body. I was just on a ratings call with S&P today, and believe me, that's a very detailed exercise. I think it's best left not in the charter. Financial practices change, tools available change. The phrasing somewhere in here is to present reasonable budget or whatever it is, a conclusive, definitive, well-orchestrated budget. I think that phrase would cover changing practices.
Further discussion? Yes. Snow Doxer.
Linda Snow Doxer, Precinct 1. I just have a question of clarification. Under 7.2, not to go back to that discussion, isn't about grammar. It relates to the discussion that we had yesterday. You have the change from newspaper to news medium. Is the assumption still that there will be a publication in the newspaper now for those who are not on internet resources, even though the charter is making it more broad?
I believe so.
So it will be assumed that it will still be in the newspaper?
As long as there's a newspaper. As long as there's a newspaper, that's...
Mr. LaLasher.
In this particular case, I don't remember a budget ever being described in the newspaper in any sense. So in this case, news medium does not mean newspaper. Lord help us if we have to publish our whole budget in the newspaper, we'd have a special edition. So in this specific case, I have to say electronic. Now, you can certainly publish some notice that there is a budget available and here it is, and some kind of article with a summary, but you don't want to publish the budget in the newspaper.
Further discussion?
My apologies, I stand corrected.
None appearing. We're ready to move on to Section 8, Charter Article 8.
Okay, Article 8. Uh, 8.1 was really just remove some redundant language and made it much more concise. Article 8.2 is reworded to increase its effectiveness. I think town council is very proud of that. He likes this severability clause. 8.3, it was meant to broaden a bit. There's a typical case of broadening from shall to may. That's what was made in 8.3 to give it a bit more extent or broaden its effectiveness. 8.4 just cleaned up some references. 8.5 is something near and dear to everyone's heart. Now that we have a town hall that's only open 4 days a week, we decided to put the language in there that counted as a day is the only a computation of time of a day is only a day that the town hall is open to the general public. And this really just has effects on open meeting postings, as to when you're calculating how many days needed to be posted for an open meeting. And it also affects if people want referenda or recall notices, and they have a certain amount of time after an action by this body to, it's in near 30 days or whatever, those days are counted on the days that the town hall's open where you can come in and get petitions. So that's the effectiveness of that. 8.6, really nothing, well, that might be an instructional motion later. 8.7 was moved to 1.6, all the definitions, as you went through before. 8.7 just had some real word changes, but didn't really affect its effect. Okay, 8.8, excuse me a minute while I check Bob's notes. It changes a couple of things. One is that we got rid of the three words within the town. If you look for meetings, that will allow or make possible the meetings of boards and committees outside of town. This has come up a number of times when boards are visiting or attending conferences and they are assembled in numbers enough to form a quorum that they should be posted or they'll be having joint committees with other towns. This will allow this to happen, whereas the current charter prohibits it because it requires all the meetings to be within the town. It carries on with down on the voting section. It ties in now with the majority votes and the changes made previously in earlier sections. It sort of coordinates with those. Talk about voting and quorums. 8.9, of course, is regarding elections, which will be sending to the state. Really, just some cleaning up and word changes, and nothing's dramatic there. 8.10, we tried to simplify the language a bit for vacancies. 8.11, again, this revolves election and recall procedures. We did try to be a little bit fairer. We said we couldn't recall someone unless they've served at least 3 months. That's a fair amount of time to give someone a shot at a position before you can recall them or try to recall them. It's also it's not bringing us in alignment with state law. The procedures for recall are now just meant to be a little broader and I guess more inclusive of the whole town. That's why there's requirements now for certain amounts from each precinct for recalls. And we move on, well, to 8.12. Correct me if I'm wrong, Bob, but this is a request from the selectmen? No, okay. There was a request sort of broadly as to how can you remove an appointed member. those of you who've served on committees for a long time know that sometimes it's very difficult to get rid of remove people who just don't show up, who you can't get in touch with, and just keep you know, rolling along. And we wanted to essentially establish the procedures by which an appointed member can be recalled, and really to give them, I guess, the what would be called due process. You have let them allow, if they object to it or don't resign and they fight it or want to fight it, they have now have the process to do it by way of a public hearing. There are three ways now that you can, an appointed committee member can be replaced. One is the appointing authority can start the process themselves, and starting the process being that you notify them and go through a hearing process. The board itself can vote to recommend to the appointing authority that an individual be removed and go through the process described, you know, to the public hearing and so forth. And the general public can do so by petition with a minimum of 100 people petitioning to remove a member, petitions the appointing authority, and then the process starts for the public hearing. So it's meant to be fair and, I guess, established. Before, if you see what it's replacing, one sentence, the previous provision was the appointing authorities may remove for cause appointees to boards, committees, commissions, committees, and offices. We thought that was a little too broad, and we wanted to have at least committee members know what their options are, let them have some options rather than just being subject to essentially the will of the appointing authority with no explanation given or no process to go through in which you could state your case as to why you shouldn't be removed. And there really wasn't anything new in 8.13 or 8.14 either. So that's the gist of it, Article 8.
Mr. Berman.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Barry Berman, Precinct 4. I know we've gone over this before, regarding the computation of time, especially when Town Hall is now no longer open on Fridays. In the definition, it says that anything that's 7 days or less are days that are counted only when Town Hall is open, but anything more than 10 days are calendar days. The notion is that if something has to occur 7 days rather than 10, that there's more urgency in something at 7 days rather than 10. However, because Town Hall is closed on Friday, essentially anything that is that has to be enacted within 7 days can be anywhere from 10 days to 13 days, depending on the day that it's enacted. So, and this doesn't include, by the way, if there's a Monday holiday. So just in a regular week, if something is enacted on a Monday, it's essentially 10 calendar days before it hits the 7 day period of time where Town Hall would be open. And if it's enacted on a Thursday, then you have 13 days because you now have two Fridays where Town Hall's not open. So I'm not gonna make an amendment or a motion, but I would just like an explanation as to if this was thought through enough, because the idea is that if you really want something enacted within 7 days with some urgency, we can just change, just get rid of anything that says 7 days, make it 10. Because the best case it will be is 10 days if it's done on a Monday. If I'm not thinking this clearly, and you guys have done it for longer, if you can sort of say as to why one is a calendar day and one is when Town Hall is open, especially since the one where Town Hall is open that you want have to have more urgency actually could make it worse.
This was one of Mr. Brown's pet projects. We'll let him answer it.
Mr. Brown.
I think, Barry, we ran into this a couple of years ago when I attempted to take out a petition to do, you know, referendum petition, and Town Council at that time said that when Town Hall opened, it does not count. And that's the reason I put it in here. And conversely, if we go back to Town Hall being open 5 days, it still remains the same thing. You're right, it could run from 10 days to 20 days, 13 days, I think I counted at one time. But really, there's only one or two days difference. But it does make a difference if you're trying to, let's say we adjourn on a Thursday night. Town hall is closed Friday. I can't get in until the next Monday. If you're coming back to what you're saying, I've lost 3 days of going out and collecting signatures. So believe me, it's difficult to get signatures for a referendum. I've done it twice. I hope I don't have to do it again, but I will, if need be. And this just clarifies it. I think we had some confusion on the open meeting laws with town clerk. And I think this clarifies it, that it stays the town hall opens. In some place in here, it used to say working days. Well, the town manager could be in there working on a Saturday. Does that count to the 7 days? We just wanted to clarify, Perry, that it's the days the town hall is open, period.
Yes. Just to finish up, yes, we did discuss this quite a bit and decided to leave it the way you see it now.
Mr. O'Rourke.
Tom O'Rourke, Precinct 2. Just a question on 881 on the meetings. Is there anything in the charter that covers the opportunity for remote participation in meetings?
Mr. LaLasha.
Or do we want to?
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. No, there's nothing in the charter. The Board of Selectmen, by state law, have the ability to declare a policy, which they have done. And when they declare a policy, it applies to all boards or committees or none. So they can't pick or choose. And the selectmen for the last couple of years have declared that all boards and committees in this town may use remote participation.
Great, thank you.
And further, there's a lot of state law that covers exactly what you can and can't do.
Further discussion? We'll come back to you. Mr. Brown, you have a comment? Oh, okay, then I'm actually gonna call on, I thought you were following up on that. Mr. Moore.
Richard Moore, Precinct 2. I have two items, and with your permission, I'll do them one at a time rather than both together. Sure. First, an amendment on 8.8.2 rules and minutes. I would like to add the phrase at the end, and on the town website. Right now it reads, each board or committee shall determine its own rules and order of business unless otherwise provided by the charter or by town bylaw, and shall provide for keeping of minutes of its proceedings. Copies of these rules and minutes shall be publicly available in the office of the town clerk and in the library, and why not have it on the town website as well?
Is this part of our change? I'm actually looking it up as we speak. Or is this part of the original charter? It was 8.8.2.
I think it's an addition. I don't think it's changing anything we did.
Right. So this is this would be out of the scope.
But to the point, though, I believe all minutes are published on the website now. I don't know that it's by being compelled to do so. The town manager, correct me if I'm wrong, but I do believe they are there now.
Mr. LaLasha?
That's correct. All minutes are available back to the beginning of time on the town's website. We don't publicize that well, because we're afraid it might not work. If you go to the lower left-hand section, I forget what it's called, you can literally look at you can do searches for topics through Board of Selectmen minutes back then, somewhere around the 12 or 1300s.
Does that include the rules as well?
Beg your pardon?
Does that include the rules as well?
No, that includes just minutes from public bodies.
Okay.
But as a practical matter, yes, that's also available on the website in general.
Okay, then since it can't be allowed, can I do my second? Sir.
Sure.
Okay. 8.8.1, this is a question. I remember being on a committee and having a tough time because of the limits on needing to post to make sure that the public could make it to meetings. What I've heard tonight is you can now meet any place, you don't have to be in the town of Reading, and I understand why that's happening. And by these changes, a committee or board can decide to meet anytime they want with no notice. Is that correct?
I think there is state requirements for that in the open meeting law.
That's correct. There's open meeting law that spells out very specific requirements about notifying the public, and this does not contradict that.
Are you saying that there are rules elsewhere that say how you have to notify? And that the, okay. What are those rules, as a question? What are those rules?
48 hours of public notice. This just says they can meet where they want. It doesn't have anything to do with how they communicate that meeting to the public.
Thank you. I'm sorry for that. Thank you.
Mr. Brown.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Bill Brown, Precinct 8. I, in fact, was going to amend 8.8.1 to insert after time and places in compliance with the open meeting laws, to make it very specific that they have to comply with the town meeting, the open meeting laws. And I think that would answer the previous question. And just for those that, one of the reasons we did, in fact, change the law, the Municipal Light Board services four towns, and they often meet, and they have met out of town, which at that time is against the bylaws, the charter.
Is this, I'm checking to see which part of the charter this is in. Is this a change that we made?
Such times and places as they may. Okay. Yeah.
It is, and I would accept that, yes. Okay, is there a second to that motion? Fine. Do we have it marked? Yes, we do. Okay. Further discussion on that, Mr. Stuhl?
I don't know if there's any problem with this, but it's really not necessary because the state law already requires this. So.
Further discussion? Mr. D'Addario?
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Ron D'Addario, Precinct 6. I'd like to make an amendment on...
Right now, we're discussing Mr.
Oh,
Brown's,
I'm sorry.
Yeah, Mr. Brown's proposed amendment.
Okay,
and then we will come back to that. Is there any discussion on Mr. Brown's amendment? None up here. Oh, can I see one? Oh, on the, yes.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Jean Browski, Precinct 6. I would tend to agree with Mr. Struble that I completely agree with the importance of open meeting law, at some point in 5, 6, 7 years, the state legislator might rewrite that law, might rename that law, and this will be out of date and confusing. We obviously all have to abide by state law that exists. Specifically naming a state law seems unnecessary and potentially confusing. So I would suggest not supporting this.
Further discussion on the proposed amendment? Yes, in the rear. Yes.
Kendra Cooper, Precinct 8. I have some real concerns about, and the open meeting law has been around a long time. It was passed in the 1960s. I don't see it going anywhere. In fact, recently the legislature put enforcement under the Attorney General's office, so it's no longer a county enforcement or district attorney accounting. I think that it's a good a suggestion, the amendment that Bill Brown has put in. I also have a concern as far as I was looking at the computation of time, and I was wondering if the town council could maybe give some comments on the open meeting law and the fact that we really do need to comply, and how is the computation of time, how does that coincide or not with notification requirements that bodies have to have as far as when there are meetings. I believe that there's probably more information. If people simply in a committee look at this charter, I'm concerned they may, you know, misunderstand or have confused what the larger requirements are from the open meeting law. Thank you.
Mr. Meares? As
So luckily, there's a provision in the charter that says when there's a reference to the general laws, if the general law changes, that the charter intends to refer to the new law rather than the old law. That might solve the problem about the open meeting law changing its name. Indeed, just not too many years ago, the open meeting law moved from where it belonged to a place where it does not belong, which is in the middle of the State Administrative Procedure Act. And that coincides with the Attorney General taking over over responsibility for the enforcement of the open meeting law, which has gotten much more draconian in the last few years. Okay, so basic requirement of the open meeting law is that all public bodies, that's the word that they use, with basically boards and committees as we use it, that meet must post their meeting, and they must do it 48 hours in advance, not including Saturdays and Sundays. So under the open meeting law, the day that when town hall is closed on Friday, that still counts as part of the 48 hours. But Saturday and Sunday do not. That's a change from a few years ago when only Sunday did not count. So as things stand today, that must be, that's the posting requirement. There's a whole set of regulations about where the posting needs to be, but basically, in Reading, I believe everything is posted on the website. Is that correct? There's presumably a notice somewhere that tells you that. The town clerk has such a notice. Okay. So that is the basic requirement. Something else that's new is that the agenda needs to be posted, and that only things that are mentioned in the agenda can be discussed at the open meeting, unless, before they start the conversation, the chair announces that the item, some new item that could not reasonably have been foreseen, needs to be added to the agenda. So if they make that announcement, then they can proceed to discuss something new that's not on the agenda. Although the Attorney General seems to think that the better practice is once it becomes known that something new is going to be discussed, that the agenda be amended and posted. And I wouldn't be surprised if we see some more requirements along those lines as well. Everything seems to be getting much tighter and more restrictive. But basically, that's the requirement. The agenda, which used to be suggestive, is now really quite prescriptive.
Further discussion on the amendment? None appearing. All those in favor of the proposed amendment, please raise your hand. Those opposed? And the chair is in doubt. All those in favor of the amendment, please rise.
Eighteen.
17, and those opposed?
Ten.
Three.
Six.
15. The vote being 65 in the affirmative, 34 in the negative, the motion carries. Further business under this section. Mr. D'Addario.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Ron D'Addario, Precinct 6. I'd like to offer an amendment on 8.8.4 on quorum. Just a little bit of grammar and a word change. I'd like to say a majority of the number of members and come in with on a board, singular, or a committee, singular, specified in the charter, or other action creating such board or committee shall constitute a quorum thereof. But a smaller number may. Now here, the word adjourn usually means to me to stop a meeting, at least until another time. And I was wondering, would the word may hold a board or committee meeting from time to time? So the word adjourn may have another meeting legally, but I would say that the person reading it generally looks at the word adjourn as to kind of at least temporarily terminate a meeting until another time. So, and if I don't understand it correctly, maybe you could explain it. Thank you.
So you proposed an amendment to remove the two S's, is that correct?
Say that again?
What was your proposed amendment?
Well, to basically, and the first line to members are on, O-N, take away, off. Members on, take off, of a board, singular, or a committee, singular, specified, etc. And then the only other change I'm suggesting is to change the word adjourn to hold a meeting.
Are you making that part of your motion?
Say again?
Are you making that last part of your motion?
Well, I'd like to at least the first part, I think, makes a lot of sense.
We'll try the second part,
I mean, there might be, perhaps this the word adjourn has other meanings, or there's another intention by the writer that I'm not aware of.
Okay, I'm going to take the first part as your proposed amendment, and then maybe we'll talk about the second part. Is there a second to that motion?
Second.
Further discussion? Oh, Mr. Meares?
Just to be clear, if you change it from of to on, it is a very big change. So the number of members of a board or committee specified in the charter. So you're talking about if a board has five members, then a majority is three. If you change it from of to on, you're talking about the number of seats that are currently filled. So if you've got three seats currently filled, a quorum would be two. That's a big difference. So it looks like just changing one letter, but it does make a big difference. The other, the boards or committees, is certainly correct. As far as the word adjourn, the point of that sentence, that part of the provision is, if you're sitting there and you don't have a quorum, you can tell everybody to go home.
Mr. Daddario, do you want to continue with your changed, both changing of to on as well as the two S's, or do you want to restrict it to the two S's? That's up to you. You've made your motion.
Well, one thought might be, would it be possible that a smaller number on the committee may hold a meeting to discuss things, but perhaps not make a decision? That's what I thought you were going for. If that's perhaps out of place here, then I would retract that and keep the word that our town council mentioned and change the plural to the singular to make it make a little more sense.
Okay, so to be clear, we're changing the boards and committees to board and committee. Pardon me? Board or committee, excuse me, yes. Okay, is there a second to that motion? Second. Further discussion? Yes, Ms. Binda?
Angela Binda, Precinct 5. I had a question about this. It seems that a quorum has been changed from what the board is specified in the charter as opposed to the number of currently serving members, which I'm wondering if that would create difficulties for some boards which might not have full membership. So if it's stated in the charter that there are nine members of the finance committee, but at any point there are not nine members of the finance committee, there are seven members of the finance committee, it would change the quorum number It wouldn't change the, why wouldn't that change the
Mr. Biaris?
Because it says the number of members specified in the charter.
Right, but that's a proposed change. So I'm saying from what it says right now, in our current charter, it says a majority of the members shall constitute a quorum. So the
And the point is, no one knows what that means.
What do you
that,
mean?
That phrase is ambiguous. Does that the number of members mean the number of members specified in the charter, or does it mean the number of specified seats that are currently held? So the language in the existing charter is not clear. This is clear.
Okay. So it's clear, but it clears, but it changes because, well, okay, I would have read that to mean that it is the members who are currently appointed.
Mm-hmm. And that's why we decided to clarify.
Pardon me?
And that's why it's being clarified, because my understanding is that that's not what the Charter Committee wanted.
Okay, but we don't know what the original intent was. So it might not be what the Charter Committee wanted, so it's a change from what is currently. So I just have a question about that, because I'm wondering if there are committees that do not have the full number of members, and that happens a lot,
mm-hmm.
does it would make it very difficult to reach a quorum. So I would like to make it also not ambiguous, but so that it means the number of members who are currently serving.
Mr. Walasha.
Thank you, Ms. Moderator. Just two quick points. A day or so, or a year or so ago, when I mentioned that the Charter Committee was rarely unanimous, one of the very few things they were unanimous of is what the meaning of the current charter was, even though it's ambiguous. And just to verify that, I actually had an email sent out to all the boards and committees as to what is your practice, just to make sure we understood it. And all the responses we got, which was not every board or committee, but a lot of them, also interpreted it the same way all the Charter Committee members were, which was the number of seats that the appointing authority specifies, divide that in half, go to the next highest number, that's a quorum. So when there's five selectmen, but there's only four current members, or let's say three, that's better, the quorum is three. No body in the town was operating under any different procedure. Who knows what the intention was of when the charter was created, but that certainly was the well understood and unanimous practice.
So
there was no change made
okay.
in the language if that intention was correct.
Okay, so when I read it, it seemed to be a change of intention, but you're saying that what you have done is just clarified common practice. Okay, thank you.
Okay, further discussion, we have an amendment before us, but further discussion on that, removing the S's? Not appearing, let's take a vote on the amendment. This removes the two S's, the boards or committees, making it board or committee. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed, motion carries. Any other business under Section 8? Yes, on the aisle.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Festo Garcia, Precinct 3. And my first time talking at one of these meetings. So. What I'm curious about is, as I read this Home Rule Charter, when I came to Section 8, it explained a lot of questions that I had in my previous readings. Now, as I look at Section 8.1 and the last paragraph in there where the town clerk is authorized to make non-substantive numbering changes, I guess I'm making an instructional motion that we renumber Article 8 as 2, and then also renumber, you know, the other articles as required. Because for me, it would have provided information on issues like counting number of days, on issues of the gender neutrality, and it would have explained it before I got into some of the heavier text in the document. I don't know if this would be allowed with the changes.
I would allow that as an amendment, but I'm going to make it allow you to make a proposed amendment to move Article 8 to make it Article 2 and then renumber.
Right, and then renumber the other articles as needed.
Okay, that's in scope. Okay. Is there a second to that? Second. Mr. Struble, do you have a comment? Oh, no. Mr. Miaris?
I love this as a concept. We will have to keep in mind that we're also considering some of these as in part of the special act. So we'll have to make all those changes in the special act as well, all before it goes to the legislature. So it's I love it as a concept. I don't like it as a task in the tight schedule that we have.
Okay.
I just wanted everybody to understand that it's not trivial what you're asking to be done.
Further discussion on the proposed amendment. Mr. D'Addario?
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Ron D'Addario, Precinct 6. I'd like to offer an amendment.
Right now we're discussing...
Oh, is this... I thought that was ended. I'm sorry.
No, we haven't voted on that yet. Further discussion on the proposed amendment. This would change Article 8 to Article 2 and then renumber everything after that. None appearing. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed? The motion does not carry. Mr. McKenzie, did you have your hand up earlier? Yes.
Bruce McKenzie, Precinct 8, thank you. Ron D'Addario, I was going to make one of the suggestions, but Ron already caught it. Three cleanups, Article 8.10, vacancies. Some cleanup on the second line, replace the words forthwith cause notice of the vacancy to be publicly available. Should be replaced with just simply publicize the vacancy. Just simple cleanup, modernizing the language.
Okay. Before I take that, I would ask the town council if he has an opinion on changing that.
I believe this is what mentioned bulletin boards, and you changed a couple of words.
Mr. McKenzie, could you repeat that and speak into the microphone, please?
On the second line, replace forthwith cause notice of the vacancy to be publicly available is replaced with publicize the vacancy.
Do you have any opinion on whether that changes the meaning?
Well, absolutely does change the meaning, but I guess there's some question as to whether this is a proposed change.
Oh, I didn't know. Let's just check that out. It's not one of the changes, is it?
I think it is.
It used to be numbered 8-12.
No, final changes. Okay. That would be outside of the scope. I'm sorry. I was thinking of the change and did not.
I was hoping
that.
To modernize the language as we were trying to. There were changes there. The word public was taken out, and the words were added publicly available, and the words were taken out posted on the town bulletin board.
I think it's a change. I think it's.
You think we have made that change?
I think that the proposed language is a significant change from what was there.
Oh, a significant change. Yeah.
So therefore, it's not outside the scope. This motion is inside the scope. That would be my opinion. It's of course your call.
True, but you're saying you think it's within because of the other changes we've made in the article.
Yes.
Just give me 1 second. Okay, I will accept that then. I will accept the, okay.
And I've got
so
two others.
There, but you, and so the original question was, is this now changing the meaning?
I was looking at your opinion on what a change it might be
so,
to what it means.
Okay, so the difference between something being publicly available and being publicized, are two, you know, those are two different things. Publicly available simply means that that one can come into town hall and get a copy. Publicized means something more than that. We haven't used that term. If you want to say that there's something more is required, you probably want to go back to publish in a local news medium. And you would want to say that you're publishing it at least 15 days prior to the appointment of a successor. So, I mean, there's some, take me a bit to write it all out, if that's what you want.
I should point out, I am allowing the proposed amendment. I actually was just asking if you thought it was a big enough change, but if you want to make that motion, I will accept it if there's a second.
So as I understand what you said, to cause notice to be publicly available just means it could be sitting somewhere in town hall, but nobody knows to ask for it. And I think that's bad. I would like it to be more widely publicized than just being sitting in town hall. Now, I guess that's a change of intent, but I would like that intent.
I'm going to accept your motion if there's a second. Is there a second? Is there further discussion on that proposed amendment while we're looking this up? Mr. Crook?
Stephen Crook, Precinct 2. So if the amendment is approved, do I read that it needs to be published for not less than 15 days? That is to say, probably 2 weeks and 1 day's worth of a daily newspaper or publication, or possibly if it's a weekly publication, maybe over the course of 15 weeks.
So the intention is to publish it and then wait 15 days.
I'm just not sure that's what it says right now. I don't doubt that that was not his intention.
Well, is there other discussion? We need to move on fast here. Is there other discussion on this? Yes, in the aisle. Mr. O'Rourke.
O'Rourke, Precinct 2. So I think it still needs to be changed. I don't think it's clear what the
They're working
is.
On it right now.
Yeah. But secondly, I mean, maybe this is obvious, but I think one issue is it's available. You can go from your home to town hall and pick it up. Publicizing, you can publicize that it's available in Europe, right? So I think there's two different meanings there. So I think the intent of the bylaw, the charter, is to say that it's accessible to the public. Not just publicizing.
I think the compromise would be to publicize that it's publicly available.
Although, yeah.
Do we have a proposed? Oh, you got it. Okay.
I hope this is what you mean.
But give it a try.
It requires that it to be published 15 days before the position is filled.
Yes, I will accept that as an amendment. I was hoping to make it short and easy to read, but well, yes, I accept that.
Okay.
So what is that the proposed change to the amendment? Okay, it's up there. Okay.
What
is
it says, shall forthwith publish notice of the vacancy in the local news medium at least 15 days prior to the time the position is actually filled.
Okay. Further discussion on the proposed amendment? Yes, Mr. Greenfield.
David Greenfield, Precinct 5. I'm going to vote against this. I think it's an undue burden. Positions are coming up and open all the time. I think that having it publicly available, if people are interested in committees, it's easy to get. And outside of the charter, quite often these could be just as a matter of course available in other ways as well without creating a requirement and a burden.
Further discussion? And appearing, we're ready for the vote. All those in favor of the proposed amendment, please raise your hand. Those opposed? And the motion does not carry. Further discussion under this section. Mr. Daddario.
Ron Daddario, thank you, Mr. Moderator. Ron Daddario, Precinct 6. I'd like to make a change of just one word in, looks like 8.11.2, recall petition. I'm looking at the, let me see. Basically, I've got the page that has the corrections, etc., in red and blue and black. But on the bottom of my page, it says the recall petition shall be returned and filed with the town clerk within 21 days following the date of the filing of the affidavit. I'm going to suggest that instead of following the date of the filing of the affidavit, that we make it 21 days following the date of the certification of the affidavit. The reason I'm saying that is once the affidavit is filed, it's filed with the town clerk, he or she has 24 hours from the receipt to submit the affidavit to the Board of Registrars of Voters, who shall certify it. Now, there's really no time at that point. There's no.
This seems like it's out of scope. This is out of scope. This is not part of the changes that are being proposed.
Okay, so we can't do anything there?
So let's move on. Is there further discussion in this section?
Mr. Moderator, I mean, there's been changes around it. Could I just ask why
you can't? This is a piece that's already been in there. This is not being proposed to be a change. So it's part of the original charter. Further discussion. We're getting very late here, and we have Ms. Snow-Doxer first. Point of order.
We need to vote right now. We're going to lose our quorum. We're going to invalidate the last two nights of our lives here. We should vote right now. Move the question.
Move the question. We have a question. The question has been moved. Is there a second? Second. All those in. Excuse me. This requires a two-thirds vote. If you are in favor of moving the question on the article, please rise. We are voting to end debate on the entire article.
Article 8.
Article 8. Article 7, excuse me. The entire, I believe your motion was for the entire warrant article. Is that correct? Correct. That's what how I told
everything,
you.
Folks.
Just, we can only do 7 at this moment. Okay. We have our counters. Good.
Eighteen.
Eighteen, and I'm sorry. 24. And those opposed to ending debate? Zero.
Two.
Four. The vote being 90 in the affirmative, 9 in the opposition, opposed, the question has been moved. We will now go directly to a vote on the motion under Article 7, which is the entire charter minus the pieces in Article 8 that we'll get to in a second. All those in favor of the motion, please raise your hand. Those opposed, then the motion carries. Mr. Pacino moves the Article 8, the motion under Article 8. Do we have a brief explanation as to what the purpose is of Article 8? Mr. Meares, you may be best suited for that.
So there's certain parts of the charter that cannot be amended in the way that you just did. They have to be done either by electing a charter commission, which will take us years, or to go for a special act. So we pulled those out, and in Article 8, we've requested that a special act be adopted making those changes. And so those are the changes that have to do with how the town meeting members are elected and recalled and all the those things, the things having to do with the appointment of the town manager and the assistant, the acting town manager. And I don't think there are any provisions about election of the Board of Selectmen. So those are the three kinds of things that have to be done by a special act. So we only have the first two. And so if you're in favor of the charter, you understand that the charter has to be amended in two processes. Most of it is going to be done by your vote now, followed by the election on April 7th. But a few provisions have to be done by special act, and that's what's called for in Article 8.
Is there any discussion under Article 8? None appearing. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed, and the motion carries. Business under Article 9, Mr. Arena. There's a motion to indefinitely postpone the business under Article 9. Is there a second? Second. Any discussion? None appearing. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed, and the motion carries. Mr. Arena moves that we take, Mr. Ensminger. We have Article 2. We have two instructional motions. Mr. Arena moves that we take Article 2 from the table. Is there a second? Second. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed, motion carries. The first one is from Ms. O'Neill. Do you have a copy of it?
I have a copy. We have.
I mean, is it on the computer? Yes, Mr. Clerk. He'll find it. The town manager will find it for you.
Yeah.
Thanks. On Monday night, we had a long and interesting and informative discussion about the firearms bylaw 8.9.1. It raised a lot of questions. I think we need more information. I think the Board of Selectmen, the town and town meeting owes it to ourselves, to the community, and to the neighbors of the Timberneck Swamp area to get this information. So I'm proposing and asking you to support this instructional motion shown above. Move that town meeting, ask the town manager and the Board of Selectmen to do the following. One, look into how and why General Bylaw 8.9.1 was amended in 2011 and report back to town meeting at its next session. Two, investigate the history of the Timberneck Swamp and how it was designated conservation land with an island of private land in the middle of it and report back to town meeting at its next session. These points can all be expanded too. This is just kind of touching quickly on some of the issues raised the other night. Three, determine and implement strategies that will in the immediate future improve the safety of nearby residents and travelers through the neighborhood of the Timberneck Swamp area. for, by example, clearly and visibly delineating the boundaries of this conservation land, posting no hunting signs on all parcels of town land, and so forth. Four, investigate the legality of transporting any type of firearm or explosives, across town land for the purposes of hunting, sporting, et cetera, and report back to town meeting at its next session. And lastly, appoint a working group to draft a revision to general bylaw 8.9.1 that protects the rights and interests of all town citizens.
Is there a second? Second? Further discussion? Ms. O'Neill? You have any? Are you,
thank you.
Oh, you're all
thank
set.
You.
Further
everyone.
Discussion? Mr. Ansman?
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Dan Edsman, I'm in general agreement with this. I'm just questioning the next town meeting language. That's probably within a month. I'm not sure we're going to be able to complete this in a month. Can we make it a future town meeting, next available town meeting, or the next practicable town meeting?
There's no objection. The change is to next available town meeting. Mr. LaLasher, did you have a comment? Oh, same comment. Okay. Further discussion? Yes, Mr. Greenfield.
David Greenfield, Precinct 5. I just 100% agree with this. Anytime you have hunting in the same space where children play, something's very wrong, and some people need to look at it. So I agree 100%.
Further discussion? Yes.
Bob Connors, Precinct 4. As the gentleman said, we may need some time to look into this, so can we make it the next annual town meeting, the one that's coming up in April? Is that enough time?
Well, we could just change it to the next available town meeting. Next annual,
yeah.
Oh, we did change it annual, I'm sorry.
Okay, good.
What's that? Is okay. Annual okay with the original motion, original mover? Okay. There's no objection, that would be the motion. Further discussion? Yes, on the end.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Barbara Faisal, Precinct 3. It's very important that we continue on with this, but I think we should expound. It's just not Timberneck Swamp. It's several other areas of the town, and I should think that they should also be included into the proposal.
Okay. Further discussion? On the end? On the edge here, Mr. O'Rourke.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Tom O'Rourke, Precinct 2. I concur with the motion. I think there was a lot of interest and concern and information shared that definitely requires us, I think, to do follow up, so I'm in favor of the motion.
Further discussion? Yes.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Harry Simmons, Precinct 4. While it's fresh in our minds, we discussed a lot about safety, and we're all for safety. We had a long discussion about how far bullets fly. This is Massachusetts. It's a shotgun state, except for coyotes. I think you hunt for coyotes with a rifle barrel, and except for the police. A shotgun has a working bird shots is like 6,100 yards. Dispersing buckshot is a more serious thing, but you gotta keep it in mind. We made a big thing about safety. And rifled, unless it's illegal, and that's another whole matter. It's a shotgun state.
Further discussion? On the end? Question, is there any further discussion? Doesn't appear to be, so we'll take a vote. All those in favor of this instructional motion, please raise your hand. Those opposed? And the motion carries. Second instructional motion, Mr. Donnelly Moran. Just to let you know, there actually was a third one that I failed to mention about the Charter Commission, but go ahead, you are next.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Charles Donnelly Moran, Precinct 7. I have an instructional motion to see if the town will vote to instruct the Board of Selectmen or Bylaw Committee to review the Charter for gender-specific language and replace such terms with modern terminology that is inclusive.
Is there a second? Second, Mr. Donnelly Moran.
The words he, his, and him are used 75 times in the Charter. Most notably, 20 of these are in reference to the town manager position. We have a problem that can be addressed often by by replacing masculine singular pronouns with either a plural pronoun or the official's title. Thank you.
Further discussion? Mr. Crook?
Stephen Crook, Precinct 2. Seeing as we just voted to change the charter, this might take some time before we come back around again to do that. However, I would offer as a friendly amendment that you change the wording to review the charter and the general bylaw. We could review the general bylaw and might possibly be able to replace with modern terminology that's inclusive to the extent that it exists in the English language.
Would the original mover be open to changing the bylaw, adding the words bylaw as well?
Yes.
Yes, okay. There's no objection. That'll be part of the main motion. Further discussion? None appearing. Oh, yes. Mr. O'Sullivan?
Patrick O'Sullivan, Precinct 5. Would this be included in the non-substantive changes the town clerk is available to make at his discretion?
I believe that refers to numbering, but I'll defer to the town council.
The answer is the only discretion we've given to the town clerk is to make changes in non-substantive changes in numbering.
Thank you.
Further discussion? Yes.
Just Linda Snow-Doxer, Precinct 1. I just have a clarification question, and had the question not been called before when my hand was up, I would have had the answer to this. Within the documents, the translation document, the wording actually does not have numbering in that translation, but in the warrant, the word numbering is added. So there are two different things, and I know we just voted on the warrant, but I'm wondering, I am not sure.
Mr. LaLasher.
Numbering is correct, and that was the final choice. There were a couple of versions that had kicked around, but numbering was the narrower purpose and the final choice.
Thank you.
Further discussion? None appearing. All those in favor of the motion, please raise your hand. Those opposed? And the motion carries. Mr. Crook? Oh, Mr. Crook, are you making the motion, the third instructional motion? Changing people who are going to make the motion? What's going on? Mr. Carpenter, are you making the motion?
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Moderator. John Carpenter, Precinct 7. Yeah, the intent of this is if there is follow-up to what we're doing now, like if the state with what they're going to review kicks back with questions or modifications,
we haven't made a motion yet. What are we?
I so move.
What is?
This.
Is it up there?
Town meeting extend the term of charter committee through April 8th.
I couldn't see it up there. Okay. Is there a second to that motion? Second. Mr. Carpenter?
Okay. The reason is, even though we've been doing this for almost a year and a half, the privilege and the excitement of continuing. It's just so that if we need to reconvene to respond to whatever the state or the attorney general kicks back, that we're able to do without having to do a whole new charter committee. So it's a housekeeping measure. Thank you.
Further discussion? None appearing. All those in favor of the motion, please raise your hand. Those opposed? Motion carries. Mr. Arena? There's a motion to adjourn this town meeting. Sine die. Is there a second? Second. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed? Motion carries. Town meeting stands adjourned. Sine die.